好，我是光启社的社长马绍阿基，欢迎您收看这一周的罗马主场 Rome Report。 在新闻的首先带您来关注耶稣诞生的白冷城。从今年三月开始爆发新冠肺炎疫情之后，巴勒斯坦政府开始对约旦河的西岸实施了限制，并且关闭白冷地区和周边的城市。有一位在白冷明爱母婴医院工作的医护人员，2013年的8月在白冷遇见了一个来自意大利的朝圣团体，他们从此建立了友谊关系。虽然在巴勒斯坦充满了挑战，然而因为有朋友的支持，让很多的医护人员都愿意留下来继续在医院工作，并且服务了无数的基督徒。
When the coronavirus was reported in Bethlehem in early March, the Palestinian Authority began imposing restrictions in the West Bank, shutting down the Bethlehem district and surrounding towns. The Caritas Baby Hospital thus found a need to adapt its mission to the challenges brought on by the pandemic.
The Ministry of Health has entrusted Caritas Baby Hospital with conducting diagnostic tests for coronavirus. There is a separate building.Here nearby, related to Caritas, and we receive all the samples.
Wafa Muslech, a Palestinian Christian who works at the hospital, says Caritas is offering other concrete forms of aid, including food, medication, and counseling.
For example, in Caritas Baby Hospital, we are doing counseling even when they call us, or we have resident mothers here who are suffered from different diseases. Their children are suffering from different diseases. They got counseling here.
In August 2013, Wafa met a Catholic community of Italian pilgrims visiting Bethlehem. She says the friendship that developed between them has become a companionship that helps her live with joy and hope in Bethlehem.
This friendship, God opened my heart and my eyes how to live the freedom within my soul, not my body. And this is something I couldn't reach it alone as a Christian Palestinian living in the Holy Land.
Although Wafa wanted to leave behind the challenges of being a Christian in Bethlehem, her friend's support gave her the strength to stay and continue working at the hospital. Countless other Christians in the Holy Land are also in need of someone to lean on, which is why they appreciate all the help they can get.
新型冠状肺炎在全球造成大流行的危机，不仅在世界各地主要城市越趋恶化，对偏远地区的影响更严重，甚至是灾难。尤其在南美洲亚马逊地区，委内瑞拉和巴西的灾情特别的惨重。在巴西的马瑙斯，他们为了埋葬疫症的受害者，挖掘万人坑的情境不仅令人悲伤，甚至可能会导致种族灭绝的危机。
If the coronavirus pandemic worsens in the world's major cities, its effects in more remote regions could be catastrophic. For example, in the Amazon, church initiatives are vital in accompanying indigenous minorities.This extreme and drastic situation helps understand the daily experience of these populations. Now that it's happening also in Europe and North America, it invites us to look for new paths. The Synod didn't propose replacing existing paths, but searching for new ones to give the Church a more concrete presence. Mauricio López is Executive Secretary of the Pan-Amazon Ecclesial Network.He says the crisis caused by the coronavirus is more serious in Amazonian countries like Ecuador, which is the region most impacted by the pandemic. He also includes Venezuela and Brazil. In Brazil, images of mass graves for coronavirus victims in Manaus are truly heartrending. Indigenous towns are especially vulnerable in these situations, since they have a very short immunologic memory.Many of these communities have only recently been contacted and are thus much more vulnerable in these situations. It's also evident that there's an absolute lack of healthcare infrastructure and of accompaniment. These are communities that, even in the 21st century, don't have access to potable water. This lack of basic hygienic material makes it difficult for them to avoid further spread of the coronavirus.
Hay un potencial genocidio.
We're facing a potential genocide. They say that because these territories face the highest levels of resource extraction to support all our Amazonian states and countries, inequality adds to the fragility of the situation, making them even more vulnerable. Pope Francis said, caring for ecosystems demands farsightedness, since no one looking for quick and easy profit is truly interested in their preservation. What Pope Francis denounces in the Laudato Si encyclical is related to our biggest vulnerability in front of pandemics. It's not that the pandemic is caused by a degradation of the environment. It's that the pandemic hits more forcefully. In other words, the epidemic evolves into a pandemic when there is a lack of equilibrium in the ecosystem. Equilibrium goes hand in hand with the extraordinary blessing Pope Francis gave during the pandemic. He called the health emergency the moment of our judgment, a time to choose what matters and what passes away, a time to separate what is necessary from what is not.
因应新冠肺炎疫情的蔓延，意大利封国两个月以来，家庭暴力求助的来电增加了64%。这是一个意大利组织抗暴妇女网路。他们从今年的3月2号到4月5号的报告，而这个组织也为幸存者提供了安全的住所，并且指导他们如何在生活当中重回正轨，如何在关系当中要求尊重。然而，封城隔离也更显得社工工作的重要性。
During the 2 months of COVID-19 lockdown in Italy, the number of calls reporting domestic abuse increased by 64%. Italian organization Dire, Women Online Against Abuse, reported from March 2nd to April 5th, 28% of callers had never rung one of their 80 anti-abuse centers before. Every woman's story is a story in itself. We don't usually receive emergency calls, but rather repeat calls from women who have difficulty talking about what they've lived and their violent situation. We've invited the women to come to our center and speak. Once there, they will start to build a path of autonomy and find freedom from violence. Violence not only affects women, but oftentimes young children as well. The Italian National Institute of Statistics reports from 2013 to 2019, 90% of abuse took place at home. It's amplified with everyone inside during the quarantine. Dire offers safe houses for survivors and instruction on how to reclaim their life and demand respect in relationships. The social worker's job is more essential with the lockdown. We are here. Don't be afraid. We are here and we will continue to be. In each location, we've gone remote through phone. Every center against violence has an emergency number. We've told women that by going remote during the lockdown, we are here for you. The safe houses are available, but many find it difficult to escape from controlling or life-threatening situations. That's why 77% of victims never report abuse, out of fear of repercussions. We see that the forced lockdown is in the same homes that are often the location of violence and abuse. We have made various strategies to help women. Go down to take out the trash and call our center against violence. We are here. Or go to the pharmacy to buy medicine and call us from there. We are here and we will respond. The forced quarantine has caused a greater attention to those who are experiencing violence behind closed doors and feel alone, especially in this time. Organizations like Dire want women to know they don't have to suffer and there is hope for healing and a future without violence and with mutual respect.
谈到家庭暴力，大多也存在于夫妻之间的互动与沟通问题。通常说我愿意是已婚人士在人生当中最重要的时刻之一，但是在现实生活当中并没有太多的资源让公教新娘和新郎为了婚配盛事充分准备。但是从2015年开始，有一个网络上的组织开拓了全新的服务模式，他们的目的是提供婚礼的灵感，以追求美德、真正的自由恋爱和最终寻获天主。
Saying I do is one of the most important moments in a married person's life. Yet oftentimes there aren't many resources to fully prepare for the sacrament as a Catholic bride or groom. That was until 2015, when an online community connecting Catholic wedding vendors and brides was launched as Spoken Bride. Co-founder Jaiza Zito explained the goal was to provide wedding inspiration that sought virtue, true freedom and love, and ultimately God.
There was a need for Catholics who worked in the wedding industry to come together as a community and as a support system in a work environment that is often very secular and very materialistic and can sometimes also be cutthroat. And on top of that, I saw an even greater need for a witness and a way of showcasing the beauty and the truth and the goodness of the sacrament of marriage within the Catholic Church.
Maybe brides and grooms enter into their wedding day with a desire to invite everyone they know into the joy of the sacrament of marriage. And when Catholic vendors are on site and able to see the vision of the bride and groom and support it with their own skills and talents, it creates a beautiful synergy that provides a love and a beauty that reveals God's grace in exponential ways.
This uniting of Catholic vendors and future spouses became even stronger as contacts were made through their vendor guide. It offers recommendations for Catholic photographers and floral designers who understand the faith, all the way to instructors for natural family planning. Accompanying that is their blog, with articles offering wedding preparation advice and planning resources. There are also explanations on what the church teaches, wedding day hacks, and best practices for having a Christ-centered ceremony.
We're hoping that having this Catholic resource will help encourage and provide support and give a source of, knowledge, empowerment to our Catholic brides, that so they don't feel so clueless walking into their wedding planning and marriage preparation.
Spoken Bride is a beautiful platform because it offers a community of women from all over the world who can share their stories and come together.
This community, created with a goal to guide brides to God amidst the bedlam of wedding planning, is able to encourage those engaged and newlyweds to keep striving in their faith. Spoken Bride affirms and celebrates this exciting time in life with everyone who comes to their page, offering much-needed relief to the worldly side of wedding planning and married life.
教宗方济各在国际护士节向护士和助产士发表了讯息，称许他们在帮助受到病毒感染的病人在医疗过程当中，尽管有自身健康的风险，仍然表现出勇气和牺牲。而这种自我牺牲也通过了众多医护人员忠勇殉职被彰显出来。
In this historic moment marked by the global health emergency caused by COVID-19, the importance of nurses' work has been rediscovered. For me, being on the front line of battle has been an enormous challenge, both on the personal and professional levels. However, it's also taught me to put things in perspective and give them the importance they deserve. I think we've learned to appreciate and cherish the daily things we used to take for granted. Pope Francis sent a message to nurses and midwives on International Nurses Day. In it, he recognizes their testimony of courage and sacrifice in helping people affected by the virus, despite the risk to their own health. This self-sacrifice is especially evident in the elevated number of medical workers who have died while faithfully carrying out their responsibilities. In Italy alone, 11% of those infected by the virus are healthcare workers. At least 160 have died. It has also increased my love for my profession. At the same time, it has made me a little more human. Sometimes we forget, while rushing through life, that one of the most important aspects of being caretakers is humanizing this role. The Pope recognizes these men and women as having said yes to a vocation. He calls them Good Samaritans, who are concerned for the lives and wounds of others. He acknowledges that they experience the trauma caused by suffering in people's lives. The message goes out in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic, well into the International Year of Nurses and Midwives.
教宗方济各最近一次在宗座大楼的图书馆讲授祈祷的要理，由于当周醒思的主题是创世奥秘，教宗告诫赞叹伟大宇宙之余，也别忘莫关人存在的意义。他说，人微不足道，生老病死，人固然脆弱，然而人也是唯一的受造物，能够意识到如此富饶美妙的造化，应该常怀希望，就不会气馁。
From the Library of the Apostolic Palace, Pope Francis continued his catechesis on prayer, reflecting on the mystery of creation. He warned against the temptation of forgetting one's own significance amid the wonders of the universe.
E in questa sconfinata vastità, che cosa è l'uomo?Quasi un nulla, dice un altro salmo, un essere che nasce, un essere che muore, una creatura fragilissima. Eppure in tutto l'universo l'essere umano è l'unica creatura consapevole di tanta profusione di bellezza.
Pope Francis said the beauty of life can open the human heart to prayer.He said men and women who pray acknowledge that hope is stronger than discouragement.
Se la vicenda della vita con tutte le sue amarezze rischia talvolta di soffocare in noi il dono della preghiera, basta la contemplazione di un cielo stellato, di un tramonto, di un fiore, per riaccendere la scintilla del ringraziamento.
Pope Francis said, life is a gift from God, too short to waste it away in sadness.
Et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
因疫情的大流行，梵蒂冈在最近举行首次网络新闻发布会，会上发布了一份文件，提及原住在自己国家里头流离失所人士的正面经验和建议。特别在意大利地区，流离失所的人士在2018年将近有4100万无家者，而他们无法受到国际法规定的难民制度保障。
The Vatican held its first virtual press conference. It presented a document of positive experiences and proposals to assist internally displaced persons.
Parliamo di sfollati interni.
Today we turn our attention to internally displaced persons. In 2018, there were 41 million. They cannot access the refugee protection system provided in international law. We wanted to bring this phenomenon to light and remember the activity that the church must and can do for them.
Imagine leaving both home and nation due to a conflict or an earthquake. This is the current situation of almost 51 million people.They live in precarious conditions, in crowded camps, temporary shelters, or barracks, without health care or educational resources. Now also facing the coronavirus, they are unprotected and scared.
Non stiamo parlando di popolazioni lontane.
We are not talking about distant populations, but people who live nearby, often next door. In my parish, in my diocese, what can I do? We hope those in this field will find needed answers in this document.
The document invites collaboration between governments and all society to help these people. In addition, it asks for guaranteed spiritual care of these people, since it is one of their basic needs. The text is freely available on the Vatican section's website and will undoubtedly help many face one of the hidden dramas of our time.
再来看一个治病的奇迹，有一位莫拉女士，她在9年前确诊得了绝症，在进行各种治疗之后，确定她的脑动脉瘤无法医治，只剩下数周的寿命。但是她的治愈奇迹却是当时仍为真福品的若望保禄二世为她代祷而改变了一切。
It's been 9 years since Floribeth Mora was diagnosed with an incurable condition. After all kinds of treatment, it was clear that her brain aneurysm had no cure, and she was given only a few weeks to live. Doctors from Costa Rica and Italy assured that there was no medical explanation for the healing. It was the intercession of then-blessed John Paul II that changed the course of history.
Y yo me levanté de mi cama.
So I got up from my bed and all I said was, Yes, Lord. From that day forward until today, I've remained standing for the honor and glory of God.
Estoy en pie para la honra y gloria de Dios.
For Marie-Simone Pierre, a French sister with advanced Parkinson's disease, everything started in 2005, weeks after the death of John Paul II. She had the same symptoms as the Pope in his final days. Her body stopped responding, despite her comparatively young age. Today, she can walk and move perfectly, thanks to the support of her entire community, who asked for the intercession of the deceased Pope.
For me, it was something wonderful, something extraordinary. At the end of Mass, I was convinced that I had been healed.
These two women from Costa Rica and France are perfectly healthy today. They will live with a special joy the first centennial of St. John Paul II's birth on May 18, 1920. Pope Francis plans to celebrate Mass this coming Monday in St. Peter's Basilica, in the chapel where St. John Paul II is buried. Floribeth and Marie-Simone Pierre's testimonies, as well as those of the postulator of the cause, and of others who have received favors from St. John Paul II, are compiled in a documentary Rome Reports will release in a few weeks.
今年5月18号是圣若望保禄二世百岁诞辰，当年教宗若望保禄二世带领教会迈向第三个千年，他同时也牧访世界各地数百次，并且对抗共产主义、极权主义，在他任内推行了梵蒂冈教廷的改革，也发展其他领域的神学。而现任教宗方济各也会在圣伯多禄大殿牧室小堂举行纪念弥撒。
Monday, May 18th marks 100 years since John Paul II was born, the pontiff who led the church on the way to the third millennium. He took more than 100 trips to different parts of the world, fought communist totalitarianism, reformed Vatican structures, and deepened theology in fields such as sexuality. In an online meeting, the postulator of his cause for canonization stressed that John Paul II's lessons are still being learned. Slava Miroder is in charge of collecting information for the cause of canonization of John Paul II's parents. In the Vatican, 100 years of John Paul II will be highly remembered. The Pope will celebrate Mass at his predecessor's grave in one of the side chapels of St. Peter's Basilica. It was John Paul II who appointed Jorge Mario Bergoglio bishop in 1992 and cardinal in 2001.
感谢您收看这一周的罗马主场 Rome Reports， 在节目的最后带您来观赏光启社的公益小短片《要有光》。我是光启社的社长马少阿基，我们下一周再会，祝福大家平安喜乐。在这个学期，就刚好有一个动画的指导课程，看到画面上，我的学生他叫卓卓，嗨，打招呼一下
，Hello，
你在哪里？
我现在是在福建福州，
在福州哈，
对，
所以其实
离台北其实超级近的，
直线距离。有没有算过直线距离？
两百公里左右，
两百公里，
两百多一点。
大概 台北开车到台中，三月中旬开学嘛，那正好就有一位学生就在福建的福州，一样的很多就是我们的陆生同学们在这个学期因为疫情的关系就没有办法回到台湾的学校来上课，正好有一位卓卓，那他这个学期是做动画专题。所以开学了以后，我们就是透过视讯的方式，
就是我们还是有能够保持一周或者平时都有沟通，然后我和我的组员也是一样的，就是经常会在 LINE 上交流一些问题，然后也会周末的时间也会来打一下电话，然后聊一聊情况，然后他们呢现在主要就是负责 绘画方面的东西，然后我主要就负责文字和企划。就是之前我们在三月份的时候要交一份企划，然后我们就有，因为企划里面有包含了分镜，然后有包含了那个角色设定和场景设定，然后他们就来画，然后我来把它整理，然后用文字方式来再来呈现它。所以说这样子其实合作上面还是挺顺利的。
你知道马绍老师是天主教友吗？那我们的教宗方济各他就说传达这个爱哦，老师对学生的爱也是一种传达的方式，透过视讯你应该有感受得到。那么在前一次你用了一个很特别的方式，对不对？你走出户外带我们去看看福州市的情况，你要不要跟大家分享一下？
是上一次，是上上周的时候和我们的老师进行视讯的联系，然后还有我的组员，他们两个人跟我们一起，我带着我的老师和我的朋友一起看了一下，应该是离我家最近的一个叫做什么，叫商业中心，类似于信义那样的一个地方，然后。就是带他们看了一下现在的福州是个什么样的状况，然后对，大致是这样子啦。
这段时间很多老师们要适应不同的教学的方式，当然透过视讯它可以有很多创意，那主要还是学生们他愿意或者希望能够跟老师配合，那老师们都很努力哦，尤其要透过视讯，每一个人好像都要开始当主播。对我来讲算是小幸运了，我本来之前就是主播，所以可以很自然地跟学生们透过视频去学习去聊天，但是怎么样子发挥创意可能再多想一下，因为也许未来的授课方式确实可以不必受到距离的关系，而是可以应用现代的科技去发挥到更大的效益。
光启社需要您的支持与赞助，可使用邮政划拨汇款，收款户名财团法人光启文教视听节目服务社，邮拨账号00035511。本节目由光启社媒体福传以爱还爱影音工程计划赞助播出。2020年耶稣会士南怀仁传需要您的支持与赞助，请扫描影片中的 QR Code 或电洽02-2771-2136转200，您的支持是我们继续前进的动力。